Hello and welcome to Hydrology Studio. Urban land development drives much of the need for performing pre- and post-development analysis. This task typically involves modeling a watershed in both its pre- and post-developed states, followed by detention pond design in order to attenuate the post-developed flows to match the pre-developed. This video steps through a sample project which demonstrates that task. To keep this simple, we're going to model a single 4-acre drainage area where its development caused an increased rate of runoff. There are four basic steps. 1, create the pre-developed hydrograph. 2, create the post-developed hydrograph. 3, design the detention pond. And 4, route the post-developed hydrograph through the pond. We'll use the rational method for creating the runoff hydrographs. And whenever we use the rational method, we want to make sure that the time interval has been set to 1 minute just to maximize the accuracy. I'll start by clicking the settings button on the ribbon menu. Click the time interval drop-down list box and select 1. Then click apply, then close. Step 1 involves creating the pre-developed hydrograph. I'll click the rational button on the ribbon menu and an icon will be placed on the canvas. And I'll select it to populate the input window and fill in the blanks. The name for this hydrograph is Pre-Dev. Its drainage area is 4.25 acres. It has a runoff coefficient of 0.68, and I'll enter a user-defined T sub C of 30 minutes. Hydrology Studio can create rational method hydrographs using either the standard or the modified methods. I'm going to use the standard here. And I'm going to leave the ascending and receding limb factors at 1. And click Compute. Now I'll create the post-developed hydrograph. Select the new icon, enter its data. Its name is PostDev. Its drainage area is also 4.25 acres. The runoff coefficient for the post-developed state increased to 0.84. The T sub C has been reduced to 20 minutes. And clicking Compute generates the hydrograph. Now let's look at the results by selecting the Charts tab. Now we can view these hydrographs individually or together by selecting both on the hydrographs list. When viewing together, we can clearly see the post-developed hydrograph has increased the runoff significantly and has peaked sooner than the pre-developed. Our objective now is to design a detention pond whose target outflows match those of the pre-developed hydrograph. To begin, I'm going to click the Pond button on the ribbon menu, which opens the Pond Designer. The Pond Designer is wizard-like in that it walks you through 3 steps. You navigate the wizard by clicking on the Back and Next buttons on the upper left. The first step allows you to estimate the required storage based on your pre- and post-developed hydrographs. And it serves as a guide for the following step where we actually build the pond. On this screen, we'll specify the pre- and post-developed hydrographs by selecting them from the drop-down list boxes. Select Hydrograph 2 as the post and Hydrograph 1 for the pre-developed. Then click Estimate Storage. And keep in mind that this is only an estimate and that the final computed storage, post-routing, may differ somewhat. Here, it indicates that the total storage needed to attenuate the 100-year peak target queue is approximately 9,757 cubic feet, and it's indicated as the shaded area on the chart. Clicking Next takes us to Step 2, Create Pond. Hydrology Studio has capacity for up to 10 unique ponds for each project. Each pond must be given a name before using, so for this pond, I'll enter Pre-Post. There are a variety of options for creating your pond. You can directly enter contours, manually enter known storages, specify underground storage chambers, or use a trapezoidal shape. You can also use a combination of those types where the program actually adds them together. For this project, I'm going to use a single trapezoidal shape. The elevation of the pond is set at 1,000 feet. It has a bottom length of 30 feet. The bottom width is also 30. The pond side slopes will be set to 2:1, and the total pond depth is 7 feet. Then click Apply. Hydrology Studio populates the adjacent table with the computed results. The surface chart option allows us to view the pond in 3D. Let's Let's take a look at the stage storage chart. And notice the dotted lines. They indicate the required storages at the various return periods. And it appears that we have more than enough storage to match our target of 9757, so we're okay here. If we had chosen a much smaller pond, the dotted line would be off the chart. Now it's time to add the outlet structures. I'll click the next button to proceed to step 3, add outlets. Hydrology Studio offers a wide variety of outlet structures and configurations. And since we're targeting multiple return periods, we're going to use a multi-stage structure like the one shown here under the riser option. We can start by clicking the cover button and then fill in the table below. The rise and span will be 18 inches. Number of barrels is 1. We'll set the invert elevation at the bottom of the pond at 1,000. The orifice coefficient is 0.6. The culvert length in our case is 25 feet. And it has a slope of 0.5%. And the Manning's end value is 0.013. And just click apply and the program will compute the stage discharge. Now let's add the riser structure. And its shape is a box. And we'll set its crest elevation at 1,006 even. I'm doing this because I really don't want the stage to ever exceed this riser crest. And if it does, I don't want it to be a controlling device. Its job is strictly to be a container for the other outlet devices, which do control the outflow. The crest length will be set at 16 feet. And note that this is the sum total of all four sides of the box. And I'm setting it to a size where I'm confident that it won't control the flow. The default weir coefficient is 3.33, and this is a multi-stage device, which means that the outflows from this device will flow through the culvert. Clicking apply generates its stage discharge. Now we'll add an orifice to take care of the two-year event. I'll click orifice and then select orifice 1 from the drop-down list. This orifice is 15 inches in diameter. It has a single barrel and will be set at elevation 1000.01. I like to set it just above the culvert invert. The orifice coefficient is 0.6, and this too is multi-stage, where its outflows travels through the culvert. And if this were unchecked, it would just act independently and its outflow would just simply exit the pond on its own. Click apply to that. And now we'll add a secondary weir to handle the 10 and 100 year periods. I'll click weir and select weir 1 from the drop-down list. And several types of weirs are available. I'm going to use a rectangular one here. And I'm going to set its crest elevation to 1,003.95 feet. By now you're probably wondering how I arrived at these device sizes and elevations. As you know, at best, Detention Pond is a two-part trial and error process. Well, Hydrology Studio has a special trial route feature that brings the two parts closer by giving you the ability to add and modify outlet structures while doing the routing in real time. This dramatically reduces time spent on design. That trial route feature was used to size these devices ahead of time. And that procedure will be revealed in a separate video. For this video, it's strictly intended to give you an introduction to the software's pond designer. Okay, so back to the secondary weir. The crest length is established to be 1 foot wide, and it's multi-stage. It is multi-stage because its flows also travel through the culvert. And clicking the Add Apply button updates the stage discharge table. Okay, this completes the required input for the outlet structures. Now let's take a quick look at the table. You'll see a column for stage, elevation, the storage at that elevation, and then a series of columns for each outlet device in the pond. Each of these values represent the outflow from that device at the given stage. The total Q column indicates the total flow exiting the pond. And the last column indicates how long it will take the pond to draw down on its own from that elevation. And notice that this grid, like many others in the program, can be exported into various file formats by right-clicking your mouse anywhere on the grid. Now let's take a look at the schematic. When viewing the schematic for the first time, circular devices may appear elliptical. Clicking on the Add Apply button will just redraw it with the correct aspect ratio. Clicking on the stage versus queue option displays our final stage storage discharge curve. It's a lot to absorb at first, but basically, as the legend shows, most of those lines indicate the discharge for a particular structure at any given elevation in the pond. The large pink line is our target. When designing ponds, your objective is to add outlet structures so that your total queue line approximately matches the target queue line as it does here. More about that in another video. One line of particular interest is called the structure HG. This is the thinner blue line, and it indicates the elevation of the water surface inside of the riser at any given total discharge. In other words, it's the head produced by the culvert. This head acts like a tailwater for the other riser-contained devices like the orifice and rectangular weir. The vertical distance between the structure HG and the culvert line is the difference between the water surface in the riser and the water surface of the pond. And as you follow the structure HG line upwards, you'll notice the distance between these two lines decreases. In other words, the riser is filling up, and the flows from the orifice and rectangular weir tail back. This is because the head against them is slowly diminishing. And near the higher stages of the chart is where the riser is completely underwater. The secondary outlet devices no longer contribute to flow. And at this point, the culvert controls what leaves the pond. I can click Finish or the Exit button to return back to the basin model. We'll begin step 4 by selecting the post-dev hydrograph and then click the Route button on the ribbon menu. Note that icons for actual ponds are not used in a basin model, only icons representing actual hydrographs. I'll double-click Hydrograph 3 and fill in the input table. I'll name it Pond Route. The inflow hydrograph is, of course, 2, and the pond we'll use is pond number 1. We'll leave everything else as is and click Compute to perform the routing and generate the hydrograph. Selecting the Charts tab reveals the resulting graph. And selecting hydrographs 1 and 3 shows how the pond routed hydrograph matches the pre-developed hydrograph. Very nice. Well, this concludes the tutorial on creating the pre and post development model. Thanks for watching, and thanks for choosing Hydrology Studio.